Okay, this is a nice picture from our campus, our main entrance, just found in these our own slides. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk today. As you said, I just landed 9:05 this morning, and we drove almost directly here, so I feel a little bit still like I'm on an airplane, but anyway. Firstly, I'll just introduce myself a little bit, what the plan is that I'll introduce myself a little bit, and then I have an example of what we in our department can do with membrane distillation, use for crop watering, actually. And at the end, I'll also just mention a few other topics that we might find relevant and that are actually the reason for us being here in South Africa this week, together with some other researchers from other universities in Denmark. This is me. Big picture, big screen. besides from it's interesting to be here, then on top of that, our university have actually decided this summer that we should commit to the Sustainable Development Goals. And that means basically that being here is also part of our strategic approaches to get into important issues and for developing the world towards a better place, a more sustainable world. So that's also a reason for us to participate and be a partner for you maybe in the future, not just for fun. Just a small slide on the size of the university where I am at. We have five faculties, and at the Faculty of Engineering where I'm placed, we have five departments. And my head of department is also here. And within the department, we have three groups of research, and I belong to life cycle engineering, actually. The example I'm going to give on membrane distillation is from some of my colleagues that work in the chemical engineering section of our university, of our department. So this is the life cycle engineering group, and the reason why I also put this slide on is because I've noticed that some of the sessions here at the conference is also maybe related to some life cycle issues. So we have a group of people working on that. And then I just try to see what is just to compare and put my world into context of your world, which of course Denmark is a different country with different issues compared to yours. I looked up some numbers that the average water use in Denmark is around 104 liters per person per day. And saying that, we're actually quite proud. We think it's a low number. Maybe not low enough for your country. And for Africa and for areas with water scarcity. That low number and how we achieve that is also a small story that I'll just mention here. I looked up some numbers here via Google. I don't know how correct they are. Around 110, 12, 50, 55, 180 liters per person per day in South Africa average, including industry. 275, okay, so 104 maybe low. Yeah, that also includes, that's private households only, so just to compare. Then our chemical engineering department, there's a lot of pictures. Picture from the lab where all the students are running around doing some experiments with membranes, actually, in two storages. Our people there have been working on all the different types of membrane technologies and what they can be used for, not only for cleaning drinking water, but also cleaning wastewater, and have a lot of contacts to different industries. And we are often collaborating with the partners, testing some of the membranes that they would like us to try out, and we ask the students to try and do a little bit of playing around with that to see how well they perform. What they are also capable of that might be of your interest is to do a lot of analysis. We have a lot of analytical equipment available for analyzing, for instance, pesticides, but there might be other interesting compounds also. So now to the interesting example that I was actually asked to try and explain to you about how we could use a membrane for producing water for crops using saline water. Basically, having a membrane with a saline water on one side. Mm-hmm. My colleague, Professor Christensen, prepared the slides. So you have a small story here. The idea is that the saline water on one side evaporates through the membrane to the soil, where the crop grow and use the water from the that evaporates through the membrane for growing. So instead of water coming from above, raining on the soil and so on, this is a way to use saline water for watering. The idea has been, if you look into sort of to other researchers and what they have done, it is a technology that has been presented before, and it's been tried patented back in, I think, 1988. We noticed that when we tried to make a patent on this technology. But what they have done is they have tried it out in a lab scale. So the problem, if there's a, for some reason, get a vapor or water into the pores, and they get liquid filled, then the technology doesn't work as we would like it to. So that is what we need to avoid. Come on. Doo-doo. Then it would work as a normal microfiltration or ultrafiltration membrane, and the salt will also penetrate the membrane. And that is basically what we were aiming to avoid. So, and to be sure of that, the pores need to be small and water clean of surfactants. So not all water is necessarily some water you can use. And what is this last slide? As I mentioned, they have tried it out in lab scale and have made it work and run in lab scale in sort of small compartments like this. A box where you have the membrane sort of dug into the soil. And in order to make it work, you need the water, the saline water, to be slightly hot, 40 to 50 degrees. But that can be done by using solar cells producing electricity for the pump and heating of the water. So that's why they think it has a great potential for use. But what it needs to be done is to sort of be expanded to large scale. This is only lab scale. But that's a job for a chemical engineer and a collaborative partner, maybe. So that was my initial presentation of an example of what we do at our department. We also have other, stories that you might know already. But in part of Denmark, there is what they call a bay of partners, where a lot of companies, each company has a different color here, mark their area, and they collaborate on, for instance, reusing the water from one production into another production. So they collaborate on water use and also on energy use, and were awarded a sustainability award last year. Another partner that we have close by is our water utility company, VCS Denmark. And as you can see, I was giving a couple of slides from my colleague Per Henrik Nielsen. They have been existing, providing water supply since 1853, but within the last 10, 15 years, suddenly environmental issues have also been a big part of the work, of the way we approach things in Denmark, of course. And they have also decided to go sustainable. So they are now working specifically to reach carbon neutrality in 2000. Yeah, I have an example of that later. But they are not only supplying our or handling our wastewater; they're also supplying our water and the low water consumption I was talking about. We sort of think it's a low water consumption in Denmark. Is mainly the reason for that is mainly this development, which are data from Odense, the city where I'm from, that this is the water use that is declined in million of cubic meter, even though the number of people in the city are going up. And that is due to, since in the sort of 93, maybe a little earlier, that the Danish society have been focusing on reducing the water use. Our approach have been putting tax on the water. I guess you might know that, and all the money that come in from that tax are reinvested in infrastructure and improval of the whole campaigns and improval of the infrastructure itself, not only for wastewater but also for water supply. There's also a tax on leaks, which means that the water company is responsible for the leaks and has to take care of reducing leaks in the system. So that has also made the water consumption one of the steps to reduce the water consumption. But also the private households have been great in reducing their everyday use, and the industry as well, because they're also paying tax. So this is just to show you. The actual water price is the blue one down here, but the rest of it is taxes that are used for either wastewater treatment. We pay to get rid of our wastewater, and then a tax on top, even more. So, not really applicable, I know. It's not the same type of society, but it's just to show that this is actually what has been the driver for changing that in our context. The other part is the wastewater treatment, where in Denmark, the whole approach to wastewater treatment is changing. We used to look at wastewater as a waste, which is quite natural, I guess. But because also of our focus on carbon neutrality, new energy system, sustainability, and so on, we are starting to look for resources in the wastewater that we might use and benefit from. This is just a talking slide. So, and as an example, we have here some data from the local wastewater treatment plant on how many kilowatt hour they use and produce. The red line is just electricity for the administration, transportation, heat consumption has been reduced. Wastewater treatment, sort of stable, a little bit up maybe. Pumping stations and making sure that they are working and maybe becoming more energy efficient. Oh, did I get one? Nope. Solar panels. They've invested in solar panels that are producing energy instead of using them. And then they're part of the treatment plant that is really giving us sort of the overall, not deficit, the other word. Yeah. that from the wastewater we also, and the sludge is used for, as the previous speaker said, producing biogas, where we use the biogas for producing heat and electricity for not only the wastewater treatment plant, but also for the neighbors around. They produce heat for around 4,000 inhabitants around the treatment plant. And that, all in all, has meant that the consumption, net consumption on energy in the company has been reduced, not yet to zero, but they are getting there. They are also involved and have been involved in some projects around the world, giving advice on how to run infrastructure and plants. Oops. Yeah, and this is another extra story that is also developing in Denmark, that a lot of the wastewater treatment plants are, because they would like to be more energy efficient, they are heading towards actually producing more energy than they are using. And especially Marselisborg in the northern part of the country have done a lot on that. And they are also looking into the resource of phosphorus in the wastewater, and so are many of the other treatment plants, in order to get another, to use of another resource in the water. That was it.
Thank you.
Thank you.